Returning now to the death of Nobel Prize-winning mathematician John Nash, I'm joined by Nash's colleague and friend Robbert Dijkgraaf, director of the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, New Jersey. So, first off, my condolences to you. What are you going to miss most about your colleague and friend?
Well, John Nash was such a presence here in Princeton. No, it's a relatively small community, and you know, he was a genius of a different kind, somebody who totally transformed mathematics, but perhaps most important, he was such a gentle and modest man, a great inspiration, I think, for all mathematicians, scientists, and human beings.
What was it about his genius that inspired generations of mathematicians? What made him him?
Well, I think many scientists and mathematicians, they try to kind of climb a mountain that is somehow out there, and there is a path, although it might be very difficult. John Nash was a mathematician who just picked his own mountains and produced results that nobody expected, that actually many people thought were impossible. And in that sense, he opened up entirely new worlds. It could have been in economics. It could have been in very abstract mathematics and geometry. He really kind of touched so many different fields.
So help somebody in the television audience understand kind of the long-term impact of John Nash's work on game theory or how we live our lives today.
So John Nash basically proved that if you have a complicated as it can be, with many players with very different strategies, that there's always kind of an optimal form where basically everybody gets the result as best as they can get. And actually, this is very interesting mathematically that it exists, but it's used everywhere. It's used when there are large auctions, whether it's selling goods or it's selling bandwidth. It's basically underlining all of mathematical economical theory at this moment. And it's kind of amazing that somebody who had a pure mathematical mind was able to solve this problem that had such an enormous impact in our lives.
You know, people who have seen the beautiful mind or ever even haggled for a price understand his impact on game theory, kind of mathematizing our decision making, right? But he was actually on his way back during this accident from an even bigger mathematical prize. So he was still accomplishing feats that most of us have never heard about.
Yes. As it said, he was the only mathematician to win the Nobel Prize. He just won the Abel Prize, which is really an award that recognizes full oeuvre. And I think it's very important to realize that he was a very broad mathematician who had this kind of unique ability to touch both our ordinary lives through his work in game theory, but also address very, very deep mathematical problems, thinking about spaces in arbitrary number of dimensions, thinking about the equations, very difficult differential equations that also govern large part of our world. Mm-hmm. He had, in that sense, I think that the recognition of his almost universal mathematical talent came at this moment. Is, however unfortunate his passing is, I'm very happy that he got his recognition as one of the greatest mathematicians of our time.
And there's also, near the end of his life, his advocacy on behalf of mental illness, which I think will be part of his legacy.
Yes, and such an uplifting story. I mean, here in Princeton, we have seen him, of course, through many decades and also in his difficult period. And he was always around. And the fact that somebody who kind of pushes his own intellect so far, perhaps further than anybody could possibly go, and then kind of climbs back and recovers. And you know, it's really kind of a Greek drama, but it's also a very uplifting story. And I think actually their work for mental health will be recognized and will be remembered and is a great inspiration to many of us.
All right, Robbert Dijkgraaf from the Institute for Advanced Study at Princeton. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.